channeling a spell. This is going to be a Fire Raga. It doesn't kill somehow, and it kills Naiad to land a kill. You
six. Oh my god!
Here. Apparently not, because she is going for the back line. This is instant casting. What a chance! What's up, everybody? My name is Kason, and welcome back to the WDL. This is our last semi-finals match. It is for the Heindler Cup. We've got two awesome best of threes for you guys today. I'm excited to jump into them, but before we do, let's take a look at the teams still standing. We've got Zeno, coach of Polarity, 9-2 record, the number one seed, has been crushing it all season, but running in to a very hot team in their own right, Inquisition, coached by Dawn, 10-3 record as well, two amazing teams. Will we see the Mace versus Axe team? I'll have to find out, as two very, very impressive showings all season. On the other side of the bracket, though, we have Impaler, who has been patiently waiting for his opponent, Odaiba Diver. 9-2 record versus 9-4 record, three-legged pants versus the Diving School. Who is going to win out in these two best of threes, and who is ultimately going to be facing off in the grand finals of this league? That is what we're going to find out today, guys. Let's jump into the fights. Game number one of the semifinals, we've got Inquisition versus Polarity, Dawn versus Zeno, and this is going to be a banger. Zeno is not running the full Mace team, it is Jaden, the Celebrated, alongside Ildira and Sosha, but that is a full Axe squad for the side of Dawn. We'll have to see how this goes, as it looks like Summer Killfig going to buff. The huge physical health shields are there for both Lucio and Jaden on the other side. However, on Zeno's side, that Jaden is a magic damage threat, which means that physical shield might not be very useful here, as the Aldir's Theorem is going to come out. This limit break is bananas. It is so damn strong. We've seen it so many times. What can Zeno do as the one seed comes in as the favorite into this series? But Dawn has been on a hot streak, so it should be interesting. But this is the Cheese Blade strategy. Aldir limit break alongside Keen Blade. All of these resistances coming online here. And Zeno's ready to go. Attritional protection is going to be nice as well, also giving some defense debuff resist, although I'm not sure how many defense breaks there are on the other side. This guaranteed hit for Zeno's Sosha, though, is really, really nice. This is a great call by him. With the evasion on the other side, Sosha can be a fantastic answer to that. We'll have to see if it pays off, as the Wind Veritas TMR is being utilized on this map here, because there's a lot of physical damage threats and a lot of units with AP problems. Even though Jaden is magic, he does have issues himself, and that is the Tonight the Moon Bleeds Red. The Lucio TMR doesn't give the AP restore, though, because of that Wind Veritas TMR. Ashen Seal going to come out here. Sosha is still way up in the air. I wonder, is this a targeted ability? Because she's been way up in the sky for a long time. We'll see. Silencing Jump comes down, and that is going to be a nice little debuff, but that 100% barrier for Cyrell is going to be nice to mitigate any of that damage. The Disrupting Axe Throw comes back for 4k here, and here comes the fight. The fight is kicking off. King of the Dead from the Lucio is going to start things here, and Sosha might be in some trouble. We'll see if she can hang on. She can't. 4,800 damage, but she is still alive, which is huge for Zeno here. She has those guaranteed hits. Can she put in work against this Earth unit as the Dispelling Descent comes out from Jaden for about 5k after that two-hitter? But Sosha trying to even things out. She's going to jump way up into the sky again, which means she is not going to catch any damage from the other team until she comes down. Ildira, however, cannot heal her because she is way up in the sky. So I don't know if this is actually working out for Zeno or if it's actually a bad thing, as it looks like Sosha's going to come down with the Jamming Dive, does really good damage, but unfortunately, she is really low on health. The Blessing from Afar coming out from Dawn's Cyrell, as the Vacuum Slash is going to pop this Sosha. However, there is still that massive physical health shield there for the Jaden. Even though Zeno is in a 2v3, he looks to be in a pretty decent spot. Magellan's Rain coming out, though. Summer Killfey is going to juke both hits, which is massive. Twisting Shieldbreaker going to break through that shield. If there was any courage, it would be removed, but there wasn't any anyway. Dispel Slam going to hit for really good damage, and Dawn is on the precipice of winning this game number one. Ildira, though, if she has anything to say about it, will come in with a huge heal, and that height 2 Kiraga means Jaden is fully healthy again. Frost Axe coming in for only 1,000. Cyrell is out of AP. Zeno might be able to withstand this damage and heal back up. 3,200 from the Mortal Draw is nothing crazy. And now the question becomes, does Jaden have the accuracy for these units? Unhappy Ending comes out for 2,200. Can't take out the Cyrell. Only has the angle for the Summer Killfey, and I don't know if they're going to have the turns to get through this. The Limit Break coming off from Killfay for 1780, not too bad. Ildira might be able to top him off one more time here, but with only 18 actions left and three still remaining, can Jaden get it done? He's going to have all the work only for himself, as Ildira, I don't think, is going to be in offensive mode at all. Constricting Cleave does finally hit the Ildira. Cyrell now completely out of AP. Summer Killfay with the Black Panther Punish. And Celebrated Jaden is dwindling in the AP department. 30 at the moment. Unhappy Ending just tickles these enemies. With only 11 actions left, it's going to be hard. The level 4 water this time instead of the cure. Ildira finally goes onto attack mode. But this means that now Jaden is susceptible. Frost Wind Axe coming out for 2k. Honestly, he is mitigating this damage extremely well. Can Lucio claim a kill? The Spell Slam is just enough to take out the Jaden. And that means that Dawn should be able to claim this game 1 victory here. Summer Killfay with the standard attack for 1300 damage, and it looks like Lucio out of AP as well, but Ildira has nothing to do but basically heal herself at the moment. She's not going to be able to take out anyone, I don't think, as it looks like all of the actions are going to go away. Summer Killfay is going to end this fight with a Constricting Cleave. There are three people alive, but two of them are on the side of Inquisition, and you might as well call him Winquisition in this game number one, as it is 1-0 in Dawn's favor. Game number two between Inquisition and Polarity here. Dawn on the precipice of making the final. Xeno is going to have to pull off the reverse sweeping it two in a row. And it looks like the teams are the same from both sides. It looks like Xeno thinks that this is the best strategy he can go with to beat this Axe team. Does it pay off this time? We'll have to find out, as Ildira is going to go for the Limit Break. And as far as I can tell, this is the same exact turn rotation up to this point. It is possible that Xeno is going to go with the same abilities and maybe just made some equipment changes. We'll have to find out here, as the Keenblade does come in. So this is the same as game number one. And Ildira coming in with the high 2 resistivity, like I said, all of the same things. There has to be something changed up here. I'm just not entirely sure what it is yet, as the attritional protection comes in from the Jaden. And Sosha, what does she have this time? It is the Dragon's Might. Again, everything the same. I don't know if that's the call from Xeno here. Axeman's adaptability coming out from the Halloween Lucio. Not only are the buffs the same, but I think the positionings are the same. Am I watching this same fight for the second time? I'm going to have to double check this in a minute here. As Ildira is going next, the Wind Veritas TMR on both sides. And we are seeing the exact same run back. Will it end up the exact same way? Dragon's Might being utilized again for a second time from Sosha, but this time look at the positioning. Look at where Sosha is compared to fight one. That is a little bit different here, as the Ashen Seal does come out from the Jaden for the second time, and this time Heart of Flutter being utilized by the Lucio. And this might be a good adjustment from Dawn, as that AP restore did not work last time. The Haste TMR being utilized by the Summer Killfay, and the Disrupting Axe Throw to remove the Protect on the Sosha. This fight has finally kicked off here. Is Sosha low enough to proc a heal from Ildira? I don't think so. Her AI normally requires her HP bar to be pretty low, and Summer Killfay says, I might just take your HP bar pretty low, as 6,700 damage is just barely not enough to take out the Sosha, and that means that Sosha might have an opportunity. But looking at the turn order, it looked like Halloween Lucio jumped in front of her. It looked like Sosha was up there, and now, not so much. Halloween Lucio is going to go next and take her out before she even gets an opportunity. And you got to be kidding me. At this moment, Dawn is up in a 3v2 in game number two over the one-seeded Xeno and Polarity. This series is not going how I expected here, as Summer Killfay is up next with the Black Panther Punish, 4,800 damage and healing herself up. Not that she needed it. She was fully healthy already. Blessing from Afar going to come out, and Halloween Lucio, if he can take down this Ildira, I think it's game over. Sealing Cleave is going to take her out, and that might just seal the deal on this series, as this is probably going to be a 2-0 in Inquisition's favor. If Jaden has anything to say about it, he is going to try and turn the table right here, but I saw somebody move. Somebody is going to juke this. Dance of the Stag King comes out. It's a lot of damage onto the Cyrell, but this Summer Killfay is putting in the work. Constricting Cleave, she is now fresh out of AP, but unless this Jaden is an absolute one-man army, this one is going to be over. Dispel Slam comes through. They still cannot get through this barrier, but the Stun Blade lands the status. Summer Killfay coming in for the standard attack. They still cannot break through this massive wall barrier here for the Jaden, but that stun is huge. He cannot return any damage. He finally gets another action. Unhappy Ending is going to spell an unhappy ending for this Cyrell, but it's still a 2v1, and he's only got 12 AP. And unfortunately, as well as Zeno did throughout this entire season, it looks like this Axe team is something that he may just not have an answer for. This Limit Break comes out from Halloween Lucille, still have not broken the 10k HP barrier. And I would say if Jaden had more AP, I would think that maybe he could come back here, but it's going to be tough and he's going to run out of actions. There's only 11 turns left. Dispel Slam does 5,500. And with only 12 AP in the tank, what is he going for here? Is this even an attack or is it a heal? Constricting Cleave is going to come out. The AP bars are so low on both sides. The Archaic Healing comes out, but that healing power down from Lucio is massive. The Dispel Slam is going to take him out. And Dawn, coach of Inquisition, pulls off the upset 2-0 series victory to claim himself a spot in the finals of the Heindler Cup. Absolutely amazing series and extremely well done by both sides. A huge congratulations to Dawn for making the finals. Heading into the second series here, we are going to find out who will be facing off against Dawn in the finals of the Heindler Cup. Will it be Impaler? Will it be Odaiba? We're going to go ahead and find out. It's Three-Legged Pants versus the Diving School here, and it looks like Double Katana plus Velis on the side of Impaler, looking to impale the enemy team with those big-ass katanas, and it looks like it is Helena the Black Rose alongside Camilo and the Ishtola on the side of the Diving School. Keenblade coming out from Rob. He says, this is my DMR. Why does everybody want to use it? It is mine. Camilo comes in with the Infreeze. This is a very interesting tech. This is, I believe, Snow's DMR, something you don't always see. The ice attack obviously is not going to benefit, but the accuracy could be important as Rob can be quite evasive. In fact, Odaiba prepping for this as the Agility and Luck Lock DMR being utilized as well. In this exact moment, though, on the side for Impaler, he is going to get his entire team hasted up and very, very speedy. The indomitability here for the Astraeus is everything you really need for him to put in work. Hone Devotion coming out from the Rob, guaranteed hut nullification. I do wonder if the accuracy is enough for Odaiba. He apparently is prepping for it, but you never really know until you know. Spell of Shielding coming in for 7,500 physical health could be important. There is a barrier break on the other side, but it is not the skill that Astraeus necessarily wants to use. The Infreeze being utilized again by the Camilo means that they are going to be quite accurate, though. Things are going to kick off with the Cross Destruction. This Ishtola level 120 unit never stood a chance. Impaler out to a very early 3v2 advantage in game number one here, as it looks like Rob does not have anything to do on his action. Fortunately, because of the haste, though, he is still going to get another opportunity before Odaiba's team is even going to go. Astraeus is going to kick things off with an arm shot onto the Camilo, 3,300 damage. He does not have his follow-up, though, as he never went for the Limit Break. And it looks like Rob Horn somehow is not in range to hit this Helena. How is that possible? This old unit, unfortunately, just not having a lot of range, it looks like. Unless this Helena is that evasive, but I don't think that's the case. Rose Fulmination going to come out. This is going to drop that magic attack resist on the Astraeus. How much damage is it going to do, though? Can he soak it up? It just one-shots, just absolutely obliterates the Rob. And this Helena is a problem. Astraeus does hang on, but he takes a decent chunk. Velis should be able to heal him back up with the snow healing, but Astraeus is going to have to put in so much work. The horizontal jump is going to completely whiff because that is a dead body over there, not a live Rob Horn. 3,300 damage from the arm shot is decent, but this map positioning is not working out in Impaler's favor as Astraeus is not able to use the skills that he really wants to use, and Helena is ready to nuke them. Rose Blast coming out for a ton of damage. The Dragon Dive lands from the Camilo, and now this is a one health Astraeus versus the world. Arm shot is going to take him out, and the Camilo popping off here is going to seal the deal on game one, and Odaiba Diver out to an early lead in this series. Game number two of this series to find out who will be in the finals with Dawn here, and Odaiba, it looks like, is switching it up. Impaler running the exact same team. So this is double missile plus Titus versus the double katana plus Velis team coming from Impaler. We've seen this team from Odaiba many, many times. But can Astraeus and Rob put them down here? As it looks like Titus as the main tank, I've said this before, is very bad versus slash damage. He does have a physical barrier, which is going to help him out, but he is not going to be able to take many hits from this Katana team. The real question is, can they get on into this backline here? We saw on game number one, the map did not pay dividends for Impaler. It was very much in Odaiba's favor. Is it going to be the same in game number two is what we're going to find out. As the Immortal Spirit is here, you can very clearly see that Titus is running a bow tie as this double Stars of Swiftness being utilized by the side of Three-Legged Pants. So this is a full Haste It Up Katana team. The Indomitability is here again. Impaler, it looks like not really switching anything up at the moment. But that could work out as this is not the same team coming out from Odaiba. He might have called this here. As it looks like that Hone Devotion coming out, Velis, nothing left to do at the moment. Elias should be in range to deal damage. She has a lot of range. The Sharpshoot comes out for 5,200. That is a very, very nice start. However, Velis might be able to heal it back up. Rugia going to come in with the Umber Bombardment, 5,500. The Rupture is going to proc the Courage. Fortunately for Impaler, that Courage is going to keep him alive. It did not get procced before the follow-up. Cross Destruction for 4,500 is really solid. Velis should be able to heal up this Astrius, so that is going to be able to save them. But Rob, again, with just not any range to speak of, is not able to get damage down yet. This Titus is going to come in. He does not have the range skills on, which is huge because Velis' casting time is taking a while. Titus might have been able to clean him up before the heal. The snow healing comes in, though. Astrius, can he clear this Titus? With the limit break, with the follow-up, I don't know if Titus is going to be able to live this. We are going to find out, though. Release the Void coming in, 2,500. That is astoundingly well tanked. I am shocked at how well Titus did versus that. He is terrible versus Slash, but Odaiba is obviously prepping very well, but this Rob comes in with massive damage. Aliyah just barely hanging on by the skin of her teeth, but Titus is going to go down. Aliyah Rundell, does she have the accuracy? How much damage is she going to go for? Is it a Sharpshoot? No, it's the Armored Boar, but it connects. 8k is going to drop the Rob, and this Rugia, who we've seen pop off time and time again, is going to go again. Dual Disruptor with lots of damage. The Rupture comes in, and it's enough to one-shot the Velis. And at this moment, Odaiba is on the precipice of joining Dawn in the finals. Deep Fortification is going to come out from this Astrius, and do these missile units kill him before he can get an opportunity to attack? Aliyah smartly is going to back up. It is basically like they're playing manual out here, how smart these units are here. She's going to move out of the way. Domain of Earth comes in again, but this Astrius cannot approach them. He cannot encroach on them. A 66 AP is plenty. He does get his courage back, which could give him an opportunity. If he is able to hit these two units, it might just be game over. He might be able to one-shot them, but he needs to get in range and not die before. This is going to be a massive limit break from the Aliyah. Guns of the Dragon Prince has 1,600 on the first hit, 2,300 on the second, but the Immobilize is going to keep him staying put. It's going to proc the Courage, which means he is a sitting duck for this Rugia. Arm Shot is going to come in for 5,800, and you gotta be kidding me. Two upsets in one video. We've got Dawn and Odaiba Diver in the grand finals of the Heindler Cup. Guys, let me know in the comments if you thought this was coming. I sure as hell did not. Honestly, absolutely amazing series. Two fantastic players who have done really well all season. But congratulations to both Dawn and Odaiba for making the finals. All right, guys, with the semifinals over and done with, this is what the Heindler bracket looks like. And I would be lying to you if I said this is what I expected. Two players who have been on amazing runs have not dropped a single game in the playoffs so far. 2-0 series wins both in the quarters and the semifinals. We have Dawn versus Odaiba. So 12-3 record versus 11-4, the 4 seed versus the 6 seed. I don't think anybody saw this coming, but it is going to be really, really interesting to see how that final series plays out. That Axe team from Dawn is just absolutely terrifying. And in a similar note, the Missile team on Odaiba is very, very strong as well. Very excited to see who is ultimately going to take that crown and that trophy from the Heindler Cup. But these are the two teams who have officially qualified for that Season 5 of Champions League. So huge congratulations to these two players. But it is not over yet, as they are going to be facing off in one more series for all of the marbles, for all the bragging rights for the Heindler Cup. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Next week, we are going to have four finals videos coming out. Every single league is the grand finals at this moment, and we're going to see who those champions are. So until next time, guys, hope you enjoyed this and have a wonderful day.